I raise a hallelujah. search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. You came along and put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Dancing, you give beauty for ashes, you turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens, you turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. You turn graves into gardens, you turn bones into armies, you turn seas into highways.
Hey. Greet each other. It's a beautiful day.
Well, Bob's up there making an announcement sign.
I can't draw that good. So for announcements, we just want to let you know. This is May, which means we have our annual business meeting on the third Sunday of May, which will be the 16th, I believe. We usually like to have it on the second Sunday, but the second Sunday in May always seems to be Mother's Day, so it's not good to do that. So come for that. We have to announce that, you know, multiple weeks in advance. Also, VBS is coming up. July 7th through the 9th is going to be evenings. What time does it start in the evening, Clara? 6 to 9 or something like that?
Midnight.
6 to midnight. Awesome. So, yeah, if you want to volunteer to help out, please do so. And I know that if you want to do food, you have to get on Kennedy's good list. As I kind of said I would do it, and she said, you got to ask me. And I'm like, okay. So if you want to help with food, ask Kennedy, talk to Kennedy. Let's give her a lot of support. Oh, I thought you were raising your hand. Like, you want to do food? Awesome. We got another one. No, just kidding. Food is a lot of fun. I enjoy it. I enjoy cooking it. I enjoy eating it. Anyway, I'm going to get off food. Was there another announcement? Mother's Day. Thank you. Yeah. One of those other holidays I never seem to remember. So we're going to have a surprise for the mothers on Mother's Day. So if you want to bring your mother, or if you are a mother, come. And I don't know what the surprise is.
If you want to pretend to be a mother.
If you want to pretend to be a mother, bring somebody next week. It'll be fun. We'll see what's going to happen. Was there anything else? Okay. Cool.
We are going to have a work day coming up.
Oh, yeah, work day. That was the other thing. That was my third thing, but then I thought it was Mother's Day when she said Mother's Day. I knew there were three, but now there's actually four. A work day. We got to have another work day coming up. We'll try to do it on the hottest day of the year. I knew I shouldn't have come to church today. If nothing else, we'll try to have some fun. Any prayer requests? This country? TJ?
I have the White Traveling Mercies.
Okay.
Driving around to the west.
Okay. Okay. Okay, we'll do that. Charlotte's mom, yes. Trying to remember her name. Bertha. Charlotte's mom, Bertha. Chuck. And Paul Thrash. Yeah, if you look around, you'll see there's a lot of empty chairs because there's people who aren't here. There's a lot of empty chairs anyway, but...
You should be a stand-up comic.
Yeah. I don't know why Linda's not here, if anybody knows why Linda's not here.
She doesn't have a car.
No car, okay. Pray for Linda to get a car or a ride. Ted's not here. He's not been doing well. Paul, pray that Paul comes back soon. So let's pray. If I can't remember everything, forgive me. The Lord has heard it all. Lord, we come to you today. Oh, and we get ready to take the offering. Lord, we come to you today. We just want to lift these requests to you for this country, which is kind of a mess. But Lord, we know that you are in control. When we pray for TJ's brother and new sister-in-laws are traveling around, give them traveling mercies. We thank you for Sean's surgery. They came home, and we pray, Lord, you continue to shrink that tumor, or the tumor goes down, nothing comes back. Let him be healed completely. And Lord, we pray for those who aren't here. Linda, she gets a ride. She doesn't need to have a car. She just needs to call someone to get a ride. And Lord, for Ted, pray continue to heal him. Help him to get better. We pray for Paul Thrash, Lord. Just continue to get him stronger and let him also get a ride to come in. And Bertha. And we pray for Bertha, Lord, that you have mercy on her. Compassion. And also for the family. We pray that they come together around you and around her. And Lord, we ask you to just bless the offering. Lord, we pray that it goes to your work and to do the things that you've called this church to do. And we ask, Lord, you bless this day, bless the sermon. Let Jim's tongue speak for you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
See. Way to start. Hold it. Before the kids are dismissed. Hey. Do you guys watch the video? Was it scary? Okay, cool. Cool. All right. So, I wanted everybody to smile this morning, so I showed that video. Do we have to worry about these things? Who's in charge? All right. So let's start. Final Destination. Who's seen the film? It's all about trying to outrun death. How it circles back around and still gets you. Unless you have eternal life. See, our final destination is different. Because our final destination is good. Full of beautiful things. Being with the Lord. Being in heaven. Like Bob always says, it took 2,000 years. Not like this earth, 6 days to create. God's still working on it. Can you imagine how beautiful that's going to be? Isn't that a cool thing? So what are the end times? Well, we're going to go into a little bit of eschatology this morning and see what they say. If I can get the next slide, please. Christian eschatology, a major branch of the study within Christian theology, deals with last things. Okay, does that mean just the end of times, or, let's find out. Such eschatology, the word derives from the two Greek roots meaning last and study. Involves a study of end things, whether of the end of individual life, or the end of the age, of the end of the world, or the nature of the kingdom of God. Now let me ask you, when things end for you here, do they end? So why are they so focused on the end? It's kind of funny. All of a sudden, they've got this big, broad thing, and they want to focus on what the end causes. We don't have an end as Christians. We only have a new beginning. So it says, broadly speaking, Christian eschatology focuses on the ultimate destiny of individual souls. You each have one of those? If you're shaking your head no, please see me after this sermon. In the entire created order, who created that? Okay. We're making some strides here. Based primarily upon biblical texts within the Old and New Testaments. Christian eschatology looks to study and discuss matters such as death and the afterlife. Is there afterlife or is there just life? Heaven and hell, is there both? The second coming of Jesus, we know that's going to happen because what does it say in the Bible? Sky will roll back, the trumpets will blare, the resurrection of the dead, the rapture, the tribulation, millennialism, the end of the world, the last judgment, and the new heaven, the new earth in the world to come. It's a lot, isn't it?
When they say end of the world, they're meaning end of the world as we know it now.
Yes. Since there's another thing after that says that there will be a new. Now, how many of us, when we were kids and people said there would be the world ending, were like, what? Wow, that's scary. See, our world doesn't end. For God so loved the world that he gave us an escape goat. It's called Jesus. It's our final boarding pass to get to somewhere so great, somewhere so beautiful, that it'll put this earth to shame. But he created this earth for us to be so beautiful. Is there anything you can look at out there that is not beautiful that God created, not that man created? Man doesn't really create things. He just takes what God has and builds them up to something different. But if you go to the mountains, if you go to your yard, if you go to the places where just God's stuff is thriving, is any of it ugly? Even water. You ever looked at a lake and watched it flow? How beautiful it is. Or we can ask Brian about the sky when he's flying those planes and the clouds are passing by. And it's so beautiful to see all these different things that God has for us. It's many things that lead to a final destination, eternal life and eternal damnation, both in which we choose to go to. We need to understand, and we talked about this in Bible study this morning, it is not God's desire that anyone perishes. God does not desire for anyone to go to hell. And it is not him who puts them there. It is by their choice of not coming to God that puts them there. How hard is it to come to God? Accept his son. It's not that hard, right? Why is it such a big fight? Why does the end times have to happen? So we can have a new beginning. So we can be with him. Does anyone go, I'd rather stay here? You see what's going on in this world? Don't you want a new beginning? Don't you want the streets that are so beautiful that when you walk on them, all you see is God's glory? What will be the signs? In 2 Timothy 3:3, it says, now, this is where we get to really have the fun. This is really going to mark it home to where you guys are going to be smiling, right? Let's see what it says. But mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal. Stay on that slide for a second, please. Do any of those sound like God? Can you see this in what's happening today? Now, there is still a lot of that love and those other things. But in Timothy, this was given to him to tell us. Not lovers of the good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, but this is the best one. Having a form of godliness, but denying its power. Guys, there will be many who have, and they still will deny. What are we to do? Peter gives us a straight up forward answer to this question, writing specifically with reference to the end of the age. When the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat, intensity. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. This one's for Bob. Peter does not suggest that believers head to the hills, adopt the fortress mentality, and start stockpiling food and weapons. See the bottom clip? I love this. I just like to run. Running is my favorite. God has an assignment for us during this time. And I love, as we get through it at the end, what it'll say to do. It's not hard. It's not difficult. It's actually just being a Christian and being a God lover. Instead, he asks, since all these things will be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God? This shouldn't make you fear. This should make you excited that he's coming back from each and every one of you because you're his. Because of which the heavens will be dissolved, being on fire, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. He repeats this just to let us know what's going to happen. Next slide, please, Edward. As Peter sees it, end time Christians are called to do what? One thing. They are to practice holiness and do good to others wherever and whenever they can. What does that mean? To love your neighbor? To show them the gospel? To give them hope? To give them mercy, grace. Not a cough drop while they're giving a sermon because you crunch it. They are supposed to work the works of God while it is day. John says, Paul seems to have been, we'll go to the next part. Paul seems to have been thinking the same way when he wrote to Galatians. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are in the household of faith. How many of those today out there feel this way? How many people are fearful of the things that are going on? Raise your hand if you've had more than five people come to you who are fearful of what's going on today. there's about five or six of us in here. Take that, just times them, there's 30 people that are lost, scared, don't know what to do. And even might end their life because they think it's a better way. It is our job to show them there is a better way. It's called God. It's called the living word of the Lord. It will not only inspire, it will give you a reason to live. It will actually give you a life to live for. See, sometimes we miss what God really wants us to do. When Saturday morning, I asked God this whole week, give me a sermon for this week. And End Times pops in my head Saturday morning as I wake up. And I start looking up stuff and sending it to Clara. Then I went and sat out on the patio and looked at the mountains and sent Clara some more stuff. As you can tell, Clara comes up with the slides and has all these unique slides. Fortify your mind, not your body. There's Jesus, there's Satan fighting for you. At the bottom it says, for the secret power of lawlessness is already at work. See, the devil's working real hard because he's got a short gap now. He's got a short time. He's panicking. You want to know who's fearful? It's Satan. You want to know why? His outcome's nothing like ours. He gets thrown into the fire, a burning sea of sulfur. We get to go to glory. We get to go to the most beautiful place that's ever been created. Can you imagine that? A God that loves us so much that his gifts don't stop. He's going to give us the most precious gift at the end, a house with him. You know, at one time Israel had that. He said, I will dwell with you. They had him right there. They gave him up. They didn't want it. They wanted to be like all the rest of the nations. But if you want to see who's trembling, you want to see who's fearing, it's Satan. Because his days are short. See, ours aren't. When we pass from this earth, we go to our new life. And it's forever. Isn't that beautiful? We get to spend an eternity with our Creator, our Master, the one that we've made this super relationship with as one. Is there anybody that would rather go to the other place? You know, as I was doing this, I started to think about VBS and all the things that this little church does, from the food bank to VBS to this school coming in, especially the school coming in, because when they came to us, they first went to their own church and they said, nope, we don't want your school. hold it, it's a Christian school, you're a Christian church. Nope, we don't want it. Stay away. Why don't they want to teach the kids about God? Or is there too much risk having them in the building? You might lose the building. Then you move to the parking lot. Then Bob will say, man, there's a bunch of empty parking spaces out here. You guys will say, why? And he'll say, because there's no cars in them. They move us from the parking lot, we'll go to the park. Guys, this is just a building. It means absolutely nothing. Is it nice to be able to sit in here in comfort? Yep. Is it nice to have all that specialized equipment? Sometimes. Until it goes. But what's forever? It's only one thing that's forever. It's our Lord Jesus Christ. And we get to join him. Isn't that cool? You know, at first I thought, how can we make this sermon about something positive? I didn't have to. God already did in the language. He said, you'll be with me. You're mine forever and ever. Does that mean we won't go through tough times? Good luck with that one. But guess what? Even when we're going through those tough times, we can look at those tough times and say, no more. I command you to leave me in my Lord's name. See, we're not here alone. We're here with him. Sometimes praying's not just enough. Sometimes we need to command it. He gave us that right. He gave us that ability, but only through him. Satan has nothing over Christians. You know the funny part is? He thought he was real clever in what he did. Falling out of heaven, becoming his own God. Then he's going to be put in his own place. You know, as I was doing this, all I could find is joy because of the promise where we're going. Maybe the song too. How can you not dance and clap your hands? All I can think about is David out celebrating in the street, doing his dance because of the Lord God. Get ready to do that dance, guys. It's around the corner. When you hear that trumpet and you see the sky fold back, we can leave all this and go to something so much better. And we can be there forever. Can you just picture what heaven will be like? Picture your best day on earth. And then take that times 1.85 kabillion, and you might have it. I don't know if that's a real number or not, but it sounded good. It's kind of like driving in this morning. Were any of you shocked? Let's see if anyone knows what I'm talking about. Was anybody shocked when they drove in the parking lot this morning? Yeah, and God was directing you where to go. And Jim Jr. to the left, to the right. Handicap now. What do you think God's doing in this Bible? He's doing the same thing. He's directing us so we can get to the right parking space and be counted. He's even got it numbered. And you know what, Jim? That's the best painting job I've seen so far, so thank you. Do you remember that one that we had that was really scary where it looked like two arrows going two different directions in one end of the building? It was a wonderful surprise. Thank you. It's the same surprise you'll have when he lets you in that gate. And you see all of that family waiting for you to welcome you. And when he says, you're his. There's probably only one other time you'll feel that elation in life, and it's probably when you're handed that baby that God just gave you as a gift. On what this life's about and what the purpose is. What a wonderful thing. And what an incredible word to be able to listen and to be able to read and to be able to follow. How many of you know that you have a room in God's house? This is the time to raise your hands, guys. I can't wait. But guess what? We got work to do till then. Get ready. Because during these times, and you saw what they're all doing, you saw that huge list, right? It's going to be really tough to be loving during that time, isn't it? That's when God wants our hearts to work the most. And believe me, the blessing that it'll give you and the smile it'll put on your face will all be worth it. Because those people that need your help need it worse than anything. They need that seed planted in good soil. Not in the rocks, not in the thorns. You can take a look at that list. I don't think he misses a single thing. Matter of fact, it's almost painful looking at that list, at what this has become. As we get into communion this morning, you have a chance to tell God, I'm yours. Man, yeah, do I screw up? Do I do some of this stuff? Oh, yeah. Even take some of these that you might not think you do. Let's just take abusive. That doesn't mean just beating on someone. That means looking at them and telling them they're not worth who they are. We've got to stop these things. Next sermon I'm going to do, I'm going to have a different list. I'm going to have a list of all the lovely and beautiful things. Because there's plenty of those in Scripture. And even these are lovely and beautiful if you change them. But you got to flip the card to the other side. You got to make them lovely and beautiful. You got to stop being the abusive. You got to stop being the proud. You got to stop being the boastful. Because none of it's yours. It's all his. What are you being boastful about? It's his. Unholy. How does unholy help you? It only tears you apart. Unforgiving. Do you want to be judged like you judge? Or do you want to be judged in God's manner, full of mercy and grace? Slanderous for what? You think you've not done the same thing they did? Without self-control. You want to be crazy and running around the streets? Brutal. Lovers of money, for what? What does it do you? Funny thing about that is money's the most dirty thing we possess in our pockets every day, they said. It's got more germs on it than anything else. And people are lovers of it. Does that mean you should give all yours up? I'd be careful. But should you help those that do not have it? Help. Even if they've done all these other things? Yep. He even commands it. Tells us to be blameless in our walk. And we will be blessed. To have a righteous attitude. And we will be blessed. See, if you take all of these, you can take the good and then you can flip them to this side, and that's what Satan does. He says, why would you want to be holy? You got to do all these things then. Man, you got to be unholy. You can do whatever you want. Self-control? Why do you want to be controlled? Someone's making you do that then. Why not just be you and go out and do whatever you want? Why love people when you can torture them? See, Satan has this whole list on his resume. That's Satan's resume right there. 20-some items, that's his resume. And he goes to the pit. Our resume's on the graceful and merciful side of God. And we get to go to see his glory. What an amazing thing. So as we get ready for this morning's communion, is there going to be a song, Jim? Okay. We're going to do a song first. Let's go ahead and pray. Dear Heavenly Lord, I thank you for this opportunity to be able to do this sermon. Lord, I thank you for giving me this sermon the other day. I don't ever want it to be about me or what I think. I want it to be about you and your glory. I want all of our lives to be in pleasing you and coming to you every day and talking and seeing what you have us to see. Lord God, as we get into communion this morning, I ask that you put our hearts and our souls in the right place to be able to come one-on-one with you and all that you have to offer us. You are an amazing God who misses nothing, who makes our life complete, and who makes us so much better. Thank you so much, and we praise you for all of it in Jesus' name, and amen.
Thy hands of me. stars. I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul.
Yes, come on up. Now, as we prepare for communion, think about that song. It's a perfect communion song, reminding us what God has done and how great He is and how little our problems are. You know, when we do communion, there's like so many different ways to go about presenting it. And we all know the bread is Jesus' body broken for us. And the blood is His blood that He shed for, or not the blood, the grape juice or wine is His blood that He shed for us so that we could have a relationship with Him. God so much wants to have a relationship, a personal, one-on-one relationship, stronger than any marriage relationship, that He sent His Son to pay the price, to pay the penalty for our sins. It's the most amazing thing that's ever happened in all time, all history. God came, says, "I love you." John 3:16, "For God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." What Jim was talking about today with the end times, we should be excited. We got to be excited. It's kind of a weird thing as Christians. It's like, wow, things are really bad, but it's something, if we recognize it as the end times. Is it the end times? Look at that list. Sure looks like it to me. Can it get worse? Yeah. Will it? Sure. But it's something we need to rejoice in, that the time is near. When we take this today, there's some things I want you to be thinking about. Things that are cluttering your heart. Go ahead. Do you have anger in your heart? Do you have unforgiveness in your heart? Do you have something in your heart that's kind of like making it harmful to your relationship with God? That's why He tells us to do this in remembrance of Him. This song, "When I think about what you've done, I scarce can take it in. That you sent your Son, He bled and died for my sins. Not for anything He did, but for what we did, so that we could have that relationship with Him." It's a tremendous thing we get to have with knowing what God has done. And we get to remember it. He's commanded us to remember it at this time, to celebrate, to remember. But I think also, I think of it as a opportunity for us to take a moment. And get our hearts right with God. Like Jim said, you want me to explain this a little bit? So you take the top piece off. I'm going to do this one wrong. It's kind of bent weird. There's a little thin film on the top. Pull that off to get the bread. And then you take the rest of it off to get to the juice. What we're going to do now is we're going to take a minute in silence. Get your heart right before God. Think of the sin that might be cluttering your life, the anger, the unforgiveness, things that may be going on. Just pray. the little piece of bread. And Jesus shared it with his disciples. He said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." He allowed that to happen because he wanted us to have a relationship with him. And the juice, you said, "This is my blood, which I shed for you. This is our forgiveness of sins, is the shed blood of Jesus Christ that covers us, so that when God looks upon us, he's not seeing us, our sinful nature. He's seeing us covered in forgiveness. He's seeing his Son. And we can have a relationship with him that he wants so desperately to have with us. Do this in remembrance of him." Lord Jesus, thank you for offering yourself, for substituting yourself for us. It should have been us on the cross, but no, it's you. Because you did not want us to suffer and die the way that you did. You want us to live for you and with you and to be in communion with you. And I pray, Lord, that you bless everyone here who's participated and joining with you in communion for the forgiveness of sins. I ask, Lord, that you just be with us this week. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. It's Communion Sunday, so we'll be taking a deacon's offering. Brian, will you be back there? So if you're able to give, we use this to help people in our congregation, sometimes outside our congregation, who have needs. And also today we'll have TJ and Chuck will be up here to pray. If anybody wants to come up with prayer, come up for prayer. Did you have any last words you wanted to say?
No, the only thing, tell the people. They're lost. That list is huge. And it's a list that is being done every day. Let it be upon your heart to change these people and take that list and let it be taken away. As you were just forgiven, let them also be. Put it upon their hearts, guys, to come to God. All it takes is a few words. They see where your heart's at. They'll ask more questions and want to be there. So